building for our youth and children. So we're having a celebration today. I invite you to stand as we open in worship.
Thank you. So I just want to say, so I was on the building committee, and we really dedicated every meeting and tried to put every decision to the Lord. And we started each meeting with prayer. We picked a Bible verse to kind of break down before we even got into the building stuff. We had a Bible verse that kind of applied to each whatever we're going through at the time. And one of the verses just has been kind of on my heart lately, and I want to share it again. It's from Luke 21:28. And it basically says, Jesus gives a big long list of things that are to kind of watch for. And he says, when these things begin to start to happen, look up. Lift up your heads because your redemption is drawing near. And obviously the world's got all kinds of crazy things going on. But we wanted this place to be a place where you look up. And that's part of the reason, like in this room, we picked these kind of fancy trusses. We wanted to have nice lighting. We wanted your eyes to go up, like where Jesus is, not down at the world, down at your phone, down at your problems. We wanted you to look up. So that's one of the driving things that was part of the design. So the building committee consisted of Tina Dale, Ryan Rusted, K.K., Francis Schaefer, Aaron Spicer, Emily Tater, and I think that's everybody, and then me and Kay. And we met for well over a year, and some of you guys have been meeting for over 2 years.
Yeah.
And I think Francis will have a little video. And God, I really feel like God assembled not just the building committee, but every person that gave a single penny to this project, and every contractor, every person that was involved. And just for example, if you remember back when we started the project, we had a big meeting, and we said, well, we were about to get the bids in. It's like, should the project move forward, or should we wait to raise more money? And when the bids came in, we were over $125,000 over what we wanted to allocate. And the question was, well, do we just wait till next year once we get enough money, or do we move forward? And I kind of made the case, this is just the start of the bidding process. Once we know what we're doing, we can get that number down. And we got the estimate below budget, and we've actually come in under budget on this whole project. And we didn't sacrifice anything. If anything, we made the building a little bit bigger. So that's God right there.
Amen. Yeah.
And we had some big challenges. One of them was just building, this whole thing with the budget thing. And then some of you may or may not know, we almost had a major fire. They were staining these trusses, and they put the rags in a bucket. And about in the middle of the night, that bucket started on fire with the rags. And it started burning up the side of the building, started melting through a window. And that was before we had the firewall. That was before any sheetrock was on. So if the building would have started fire, it would have quickly spread, not just through the addition, but into the existing church. And at the very least, there would have been complete smoke damage through the whole church because it was really cold out, and it causes the smoke to just pull through the whole wall. It would have been a major, major disaster. And God, he sent somebody by at the right time, called the fire department, and it was a total miracle. So we had the fire, we had a major shift in who was going to do the finishing work at the end, and God just brought in people to fill that gap. And this whole thing was done when there was a major shutdown in the whole country. So getting like lights, getting all kinds of supplies. And so that was a challenge in itself. And if we would have waited, the price of this building would have gone up by like 20%.
Yeah, I had one person tell me about 31% higher with supplies and just everything.
Over $100,000 more, So God was involved in this whole thing. And we just had an amazing team. And Kay, I feel so invested in doing this project right because I believe in Kay and what she's doing for all these kids.
Yes.
And I think the lives that she's touching. eternally changed from death to life, going to heaven because of things they learned in this building and out of her. And everybody's sheep. want you to know, everybody who did donate, we try to make every dollar count. We made every, we didn't want to do things cheap, but we wanted to get as much value as we could because we wanted to do it right for the Lord. We didn't want to be extravagant, but we wanted to do it right so it's all something we could be proud of. And we just wanted to kind of make it so we could look up, look towards Jesus, and just say thank you.
And even in the Nine Square area, the lights are, so the sun comes in, it looks like the light shining. That was all, if you look around, there's a lot of little different details that were put in, even the crosses on the metal walls were things. There was little accents everywhere just to try to think of Christ through it all. So.
Oh, so I almost forgot. So a lot of these contractors, they gave big discounts just because we'd asked. This is for the church, this is for the kids. And they would, like the site work guy, when we were so over budget, I said, is there anything you can do? He said, well, his bid was like $30,000. He had given a really low bid anyway. He said, take another $5,000 off of it. And he was done with his work, you know, months and months ago. And I got this letter, and it basically said, I'll read it to you. It said, Brad, Tom told me to send this to you. You know where it needs to go. They sent another check in just to support project. So another $500
awesome.
Just out of another subcontract. And the electrician, Don Hendricks, was awesome. Stelter's drywall, Brandon Nelson. Like, there's so many people that went above and beyond. And this was from check was from Otter Tail Aggregates. So
that's really awesome.
If you ever have work to do, talk to Kay or talk to me, and we can tell you which businesses we work with and which ones were so supportive.
Yay! Yeah.
This is a really awesome place to be on Wednesday night. Hey, if you want to talk more than that with Bible studies and
study groups, the church is always open.
Yeah, study groups and stuff. So this is being used way beyond just on a Wednesday night for the youth to come to. And just talking to some of them, it's giving them a place that they can come and feel like they belong and get frustrations out and just all kinds of stuff that we as adults might not even take into consideration as far as what happens with those youth. So it's really awesome, and I just wanted to personally thank you guys.
Okay, Catherine.
Hey, Brad, thank you. And by the way, do you guys all hear me okay? You're only using a microphone. We're a small room, my voice carries. Well, this is a special morning. We get to celebrate all that God's done. And I know for me, I'm just kind of blown away looking at the ways that God provided. It's pretty amazing that we get to do this. And this morning's going to be a little bit different than usual. You're going to have a mixture. We're going to have some videos of people sharing ways they saw God show up. We're going to have a video from Francis Seifert. Then we're going to do some music. We're going to do a few more videos. And then take some time to really kind of pray over the building and have communion together. So I'm going to pray for us, and then listen to what Francis has to say. Father, I want to thank you so much that we can be here. And Lord, this is a special morning. May you anoint this morning. Father, may you fill this place with your presence and look forward to what you have in store. In the name of Jesus, amen. Take a listen to Francis.
Good morning. And I've had the privilege of being on the building committee here at Crosspoint for about the last 2.5 years. And I've had an excellent team that we worked together well, and everyone had brought their own talents to the table. And they've been an excellent crew. Emily and Tina, Kay, Ryan, Brad, Pastor Michael, and Aaron Spicer. They're very talented people in what they're doing, and everything went together well. If you, when you come across these people, just give them encouragement. And I was asked, but when I see God show up in this project, and I've seen him from the very first day when the idea came up, the idea that we needed more room, and that was Scott's idea, and I'm happy to say that Cross Point took off with it, and what you see today is what we're sitting in. And it's been a joy, like I said, to be in on the project. There were many challenges, but God was in that too, and he got us through each one. Finances came together very well, and that was in the hand of God. And now soon there will be, or is, the young people meeting and enjoying the space and having fun. And these are the future leaders of America. And many times we think of future leaders of America as being politicians. I think of future leaders as being the people in the lines at the checkout, the people who do construction work, the people that make this whole world go around, the laborers, the farmers, the farmhands, and bank presidents, and bank tellers. And these are what we have here today. And I just ask you to pray for these young people, that when they go out into the world, they will be strong in Christ, that that's will be their backing. And thank you for the teachers, the people that work with them, and pray for them, people. We should be happily rejoicing in what we have here. I thought this morning of when David, the ark was being brought back to the city of David, he danced before it. He was excited and happy because he, in his mind, God was coming home and he could be close to him. And I just encourage you to pray, to be excited about what God has done for us, and just be really rejoicing and have a happy spirit. We're in some tough times right now, and the challenges that we face, but God is still there. He has never left, and he never will leave us.
Good morning, Cross Point.
Good morning.
My name is Dan. I'm one of the elders here at this church. And from listening through Brad, all the things that God has done in and about this church, let's just open this day giving our Lord thanks and praise for all that he's done and all he's doing. Oh, in Jesus' name, Father God, we all come before you with thanks this day, Father. Lord, we thank you for what you are doing in and about this church, Lord. God, we just thank you for guiding it and leading it as you have and protecting it as you have. Father, we just pray that once again you just guide and lead this church. Help this church, Father, to bring many to you. Help us to bring many to you and just to lead us on our journey. Father, we just ask that you help us all, Father, to love the way that you love, Father. Help us all to forgive the way that you forgive, Lord. Lord, we just thank you for giving up your one and only Son for us, Father, for your love. And we just thank you for that. And Jesus, we just thank you for willingly dying on that cross for our sins. We just thank you. We give you all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise. And we just ask you to bless this service, Father, this morning. We pray that your spirit just flows freely, Father, and just let it be, just let us feel your love. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So as we continue into a time of worship and celebration for us, God has done in the construction of this building, all the ways that he's provided. I want to read from a passage of scripture in 1 Kings. It's actually something I just finished reading in my own personal Bible time. Solomon's dedicated the newly built temple, prayed over it, and he finally gives it a blessing. He says, and this is 1 Kings 8, 54 to 60, he says, when Solomon had finished all these prayers and supplications to the Lord, he rose from before the altar of the Lord, where he had been kneeling with his hands spread out toward heaven. He stood and blessed the whole assembly of Israel in a loud voice, saying, praise be to the Lord, who has given rest to his people Israel, just as he promised. Not one word has failed of all the good promises he gave through his servant Moses. May the Lord our God be with us as he was with our ancestors. May he never leave us nor forsake us. May he turn our hearts to him, to walk in obedience to him, and keep the commands, decrees, and laws he gave our ancestors. And may these words of mine, which I have prayed before the Lord, be near to the Lord our God day and night, that he may uphold the cause of his servant and the cause of his people Israel, according to each day's need. so that all the peoples of the earth may know that the Lord is God, and that there is no other. Amen.
Amen.
I invite you to stand as we enter into a time of celebration, sing Build Your Kingdom.
Oh,
Thank you.
undeserving. It's so in awe of who you are, Lord. In this year, may you become greater and you become less. Lord, as we continue to be amazed by the way that you have moved, miracles you have done, what we believe, that you are moving among your people. You're building your kingdom here on earth at Crosspoint and Pearl. Help us to see. Help us to look for the good. Look for you moving, Lord. Help us be bold. May you come and exalt you in all of our actions. Realize how great you are. In your name, Jesus, we pray. Your great name. Amen.
You may be seated. Thank you so much, team. And by the way, it's no accident that we have two of our teens are part of Praise Steve this morning. We brought Kirsten up here. It's good to have you. With new building gets meeting every Wednesday night, so it's pretty cool having some music with us. We're going to do a few more videos. First one is from Dory Mitchell, and the second one is from a number of the teens and leaders. So go ahead and take a look at the screen.
Well, to see all that God has been doing. When I think of this year and how it seemed like everything went to a standstill, and yet our building project just kept going on. And I would come in and I would see all different kinds of people that were just scurrying around getting this or that done and using the gifts that God had given them to complete this building. And so I just reminded there are two things that last through eternity, people and God's word. And that is exactly what this building represents, is that people will be coming and going, God's word will be shared, and all of this will last throughout eternity.
We want to take a moment just kind of pray together and dedicate this building. And if anyone wants to share, I know you already shared, most of you already shared one way or another, but there's so many things we want to pray over this building. We want to see God use this place, see teens come to know Christ, see parents come to know Christ, see our kids fall in love with Jesus. You know, one thing that's kind of my heart is that we really steward this building well. You know, churches tend to fall in kind of two extremes. One extreme is to treat it as a temple. Which you go back to the Old Testament, the temple was the place that God dwelt. It was a sacred, holy place. And in the New Testament, there's a change that God no longer dwells in the building, but dwells in his people. That's about the people. And so often we can shift back from that temple mindset and think the building is more important than the people. May that never be the case. May our focus always be on people. At the same time, remember that this is not a disposable resource. God has given us this building, and we want to treat it with care. We want to treat it well. We want to be here for a long time, again, to bless families, for the kingdom of heaven to grow and burn because of what happens here. So we're going to take a moment to pray, and I'm going to ask, Dan, you already prayed this morning, so I'm going to ask Lance and Charlie if you pray, and then I'll close. Let us pray over this whole building.
Dear Heavenly Father, I lift this building up. I lift the entire congregation up to you, Lord. This congregation has gotten behind this building and just made it possible. Lord, the building is one thing, but the lives that are changed inside this building are completely different. And those lives, Lord, will go out into the community and change more lives. And Lord, we just ask that you help keep our focus on the lives in this building, as well as the building itself, Lord. Yes. Lord, continue to bless it and continue to bless this congregation as they so willingly give to your causes and building the kingdom, Lord.
Dear Heavenly Father, I just stand here today with a grateful heart of what you have given. And sometimes it's hard to be a grateful receiver, but in this case, it's twofold. I see our blessings just gathering in here and then going out and spreading it to others. Lord, just continue your great works through this place.
Amen.
And in this year of 2020, where it was so hard, we look to 2021 as this place being kind of that light on the hill that people look to that say, what's going on there? There's something different. And Lord, we just know it's you and that you are here and you're blessing all of us through this. So Lord, just, I cannot say thanks enough.
Amen. Father, in this room, we want this to not only be a testament of your faithfulness in providing the building, but your faithfulness in transforming lives. Father, we want to see story after story of chains that are broken, of people who are set free. Lord, when our teens are gathered in this room, may they be celebrating you. May they just be in love with the name of Jesus. May they have a greater and greater vision of who you are and how much you love them and what kind of life you want them to experience through you. Father, we think of the game room, Lord. May that be a safe place, a place where an encouraging word is always spoken, where a non-believing kid will come in and sense there is something different about the people that are here because they carry the name of Jesus. Think for our kids right now, Tina, she's with the kids right now. Fill her with just excitement and passion. May you develop her team. May those kids, may that be a place of safety and a place of love that lays the foundation for a lifelong walk with you. Father, we look forward to hearing all the stories, how you're going to use this, and not just with kids and with teens, but also to reach their parents, also for whole families to be redeemed as a result of what you did here. Father, we pray that, and we want to dedicate this building to you in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You're free. You may go over and be seated. Just so you know, one thing we do still plan on doing, if you want to do an open house, that we open this up to the community. We felt that in the midst of a pandemic was not the best time to do that. So we'll be doing that at some point. But we didn't want to wait several months to dedicate this building. It's being used. We want to see God changing lives and
Amen.
Probably do that now. Hold on the way in. We have the communion cups out, and I put a communion cup right here. Did my wife take it? Can someone run and grab me a communion cup? know, I'm just going to share for a few minutes about communion. You know, we do this once a month. And when we take communion, this is no small thing. This is a very sacred thing. And I know too often in my life, I've taken it too lightly. I remember several years ago, I think when Maya was 3 years old, she was in church and we're going to take communion. And she thinks it's snack time. And she yells out, "I want, you know, some of the body and blood." This is not snack time. And there's many different layers that go into this. Recently, I was reading in my Bible, and we have a couple different places it talks about communion. One place is in 1 Corinthians. The Apostle Paul is writing about it, and he says this in 1 Corinthians 11, starting in verse 23. "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Now, usually when we read this, we focus on the idea of remembrance. And when we take communion, we remember Jesus' sacrifice for us. But there's something else in here that we tend to miss. You know, when Jesus says that this cup is the new covenant in my blood, for all of the disciples around Jesus, that would have sparked a memory. That would have sparked an image in their mind. It would have been an image from the book of Exodus. Most of you know the story of Exodus. You have the people of Israel. God frees them from slavery. He brings them to Mount Sinai. And at Mount Sinai, God meets with them, and they form this covenant in which God promises he'll be their God. He'll protect them. He will bless them. They will be his treasured possession. They'll be a kingdom of priests. And God gives them directions on how to be a kingdom of priests, how to be his people. And that if they are faithful to their side, then God will be faithful to his side also. We have the story of Exodus chapter 24 in which they confirm the covenant. I read a little bit here. Verse 3, "When Moses went and told the people all the Lord's words and laws, they responded with one voice, 'Everything the Lord has said, we will do.' Moses then wrote down everything the Lord had said. He got up early the next morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain and set up 12 stone pillars representing the 12 tribes of Israel. Then he sent young Israelite men, and they offered burnt offerings and sacrificed young bulls as fellowship offerings to the Lord." Now pause there a moment. There's two different kinds of sacrifices. The first one we're very familiar with. It would be a burnt offering. It would be an atonement. That for the Israelites, they knew they had sinned. They knew that they deserved God's judgment. So they would take a lamb, and they would sacrifice that lamb. And that lamb, essentially, the punishment would be laid on the lamb. The lamb would serve the sentence that they deserve as a way of potentially receiving God's forgiveness. But secondly, there's something called a fellowship offering. We don't know a whole lot about that, unless we don't talk about it a whole lot. But in the ancient world, it was quite common that, say, with two nations would form a treaty. Two warring nations, they would offer gifts to each other as a way of saying, "You have my goodwill. Restoration is established. We are now at peace." And this is kind of the offering that it was. It was a way of saying, yes, we've been forgiven, but also, God, we're embracing this covenant, restoration of the relationship. The sense that them and God were no longer hostile, but they were at peace. They were reunited. Then, verse 6, "Moses took half of the blood and put it in the bowls, and the other half he splashed against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it to the people. And they responded, 'We will do everything the Lord has said. We will obey.' Moses then took the blood, sprinkled it on the people, and said, 'This is the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words.'" Moses takes the blood and sprinkles it on them, and they wonder what they're thinking. You know, they're thinking, "How am I going to get the stain out of my clothes?" No, that's not what they're thinking. What they're thinking is, as he does that, It's a way of symbolically saying, all right, you are now a part of this community of the people of the covenant. By being sprinkled, you have agreed to what God says, and God is pouring out his love on you. For the people who have been called to be a holy nation, it was saying, you are now in. You are now a part of being God's people. Now you fast forward to Jesus on that night when he's with his disciples. When he talks about a new covenant by his blood, they would remember back to that scene when Moses is sprinkling blood on the people. And that Jesus is doing something similar. He's saying that they are now part of a new covenant. It retains some of the old. I mean, just like in the old, people who had been freed from slavery that were brought into the kingdom of God, it retains that, but sacrifice is quite different. You know, back then, they're the ones that offered the sacrifices. They offered the burnt offering. They offered the peace offering. But who offers the offering this time? It's God himself, through the life of Jesus. And notice, as Moses sprinkles them on the outside, this new covenant as one from the inside. And then Jesus says, hearts that belong to God. An inward part of being God's community. And when Paul says, and Jesus said, that every time they would take communion, do it in remembrance of him, it's more than just remembering Jesus. It's remembering the covenant that we've been called to be part of. Remembering that we have been sprinkled by the blood of Jesus. We have been welcomed into this community of the people of God. And every time we take it, we're saying again and again, God, I embrace that. I welcome that. You know, we embrace the freedom. We embrace the forgiveness. But also remembering that we are called to be holy, that we are the people of God, and saying, God, I'm submitting myself to you and to your lordship. What we're going to do for the next couple minutes, in a moment I'm going to ask Kay's back there to kind of dim the lights. And we're going to take a few moments, be a little quiet. I want to ask you to ask God to search your heart. Many of you here right now, man, you are on fire for God. Man, you, like, when it comes to being a part of the kingdom of God, you're like, God, oh, yes, I'm there. And if that's you, I want to invite you to embrace communion, take communion. Maybe you're here and you're a Christian, but you recognize, man, my life is not where it should be right now. And if that's you, then maybe take some time in your heart right with God. Maybe if you're not even close to there, you don't have to take communion. There's freedom not to do that. It's more important your heart be right with God than to do this. Maybe you're not a Christian. If you're not Christian, maybe God is saying right now it's time to say yes to him and embrace his covenant. Take a few moments just to be quiet. And then I'm going to put some soft music on. I want to invite you, when you feel ready, either take communion on your own, or you can do it with your family. If you don't feel ready, that's fine also. We're going to take about 3-4 minutes for you to be with God and for you to take communion on your own or with those around you as an act of worship, as a way of not just remembering, but saying yes. Yes to what you have done. Yes to being a part of your family. I'm going to pray for us. Take some time. I'll come and pray over to you. Father, right now, we gather in this room on this special occasion. We remember that not only were you faithful in giving us this building, but you were faithful in drawing every one of us toward you. Father, you paid the sacrifice so we could be a part of your family, so we could be called the sons and daughters of God, that we could be your treasured possession, be a holy priesthood. And Father, I do pray that you would search our hearts. Father, if there's any rebellion going on right now, Lord, may now be the time that we lay at your feet and align ourselves with you. If someone doesn't know you, Father, may you speak to their heart and pour out your love on them. Right now, Lord, draw us closer to your love. In the name of Jesus, amen.
full of worship, to embrace the freedom of being forgiven, free from sin, be welcome to your family. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Don't leave yet. We're going to close with one last thing. I want you to sing.